pi is a kind of the most famous number in math. It's the sort of celebrity number. But before we get to pi, let's have a look at one of the simplest yet most significant geometric shapes, circle. When it comes to geometry, a circle is just a curve that connects all the points that are equidistant from another single point. To get to the things, start with a single point. Let's now begin to draw points that are equally spaced from it. This point is a unit distance away to the right. Let's now look at a place that's a unit distance away, but facing another direction. Keep on drawing such points in different directions. Do you notice a pattern as the number of points increases? Yes, you got it. It's a circle. That's why a circle is defined as the curve joining a set of points that are equidistant from a center point. However, one crucial question remains unanswered. In order to draw a circle, how many points are required? More the number of equidistant points, more the shape will look like a circle. To obtain a perfect circle, we theoretically require an infinite number of points. Let me show you how it works. Initially, take four equidistant points from another point. Joining these points will form a rectangle. Now draw two more equidistant points, such that we come with a hexagon that have six sides. Now dissect the hexagon to a 12-sided shape. After working out the 12-gon shape, we further add on the points to make it a 24-gon, then 48-gon, and so on. What's the most important conclusion to draw from all of this? More the number of points we add, closer the shape gets to a circle. Idealistically, we must have infinite equidistant points from the pattern to be a perfect circle. Thus, a simple shape like circle is so heavily dependent on the not-so-simple concept of infinity. This is one more application of infinity you can add on the video, Legendary Explanation of Infinity and Calculus in One Video. The link to this video has been provided in the description box. Now that we know what circle is, let's learn about different components that make up a circle. First of all, we have the original point that we started with. That point is referred to as the origin, or the center, of the circle. The distance between center and equidistant points on the circle is the next item on the list. We refer to this distance as the radius. Another significant circle dimension is called the diameter. The diameter is calculated by starting at one point of the circle and drawing a straight line through the center to the other side. To put it another way, two radius lines drawn in opposite directions is same as the diameter. The circle's perimeter is made up of all the equidistant points we drew. Remember that perimeter is just the distance all the way around a shape. Due to the uniqueness of a circle's shape, the area around it has a special name. The circumference is the term used to describe it. A circle's circumference measures the distance around it. Having had so much discussion on circle, now let's see what is pi. Pi is the ratio of all the way around it to all the way across it, its circumference to its diameter. Since pi is the relationship of the circumference to the diameter, no matter how big or how small a circle is, the value of pi remains the same. The radius and circumference adjust to same proportion to keep pi value constant. To get the value of pi, we must find how many times the diameter goes into the circumference of a circle. But first, pi with pizzas. Remove the crust from one pizza and place it on top of the others. And you'll find it goes across three and a bit pizzas. This is pi. This little overhang going onto the fourth pizza is roughly 0.14 times its diameter. Thus, circumference of a circle is roughly 3.14 times its diameter. Furthermore, pi has a connection to the area of a circle, which is equal to pi r squared. But why is it pi r squared? Take a pizza and cut it into very thin slices, and then form these slices into a rectangle. This rectangle's area is now equal to the product of its length and width. Because half of the crust is on one side and the half on other, the rectangle's length is pi d divided by 2, or pi r. The width of rectangle is equal to length of a slice of pizza, or the radius of the original circle. So, area is pi r times r, or pi r squared. If we keep the radius as unit distance, then the area of a unit circle is just pi. So, pi can be defined as the area of a circle with unit radius, and its value is approximated at 3.14. But is the pi value as simple as 3.14? Pi is a little more complicated than that. 3.14 is the number obtained by rounding off the actual pi value to two decimal places. And we actually have to round pi off because it's a type of number that's called irrational. Unlike rational numbers, irrational numbers are infinitely divisible. Irrational numbers are transcendental and have decimal digits that go on endlessly. To be more precise, pi is 3.14159265353589793238, and the decimal digits keep on going forever without repeating. Now let's see why pi is an endlessly going on decimal number. Draw a triangle with equal sides inside a circle. This is called an inscribed triangle with all the vertices on the circumference of the circle. Let's say a ball rolls over the circumference of a circle, all the way around. This is a longer path for the ball than the path it rolls over the straight lines of a triangle. Now consider a triangle that goes outside with three equal sides. This is a circumscribed triangle with its sides tangent to the circle. Now clearly, the circumference of circle is less than the perimeter of the circumscribed triangle. This way, we get the upper limit and lower limit of the circumference of a circle. The upper limit becomes the perimeter of a circumscribed triangle, and the lower limit becomes the perimeter of an inscribed triangle. To narrow down the range, take a circle and draw a hexagon inside it. Bisect the hexagon to 12-sided polygon. Keep on bisecting by the time you get to the 96-sided polygon. A 96-sided inscribed polygon will let you find the lower limit of pi. To get an upper limit, we must circumscribe the polygon over the circle. Doing so will give a closer bound of pi value that is between 3.1429 and 3.1408. If we keep on adding the sides to the circumscribed and inscribed polygon, we keep on narrowing down the pi bound and adding on more decimal digits to upper and lower limits for a more precise estimate of pi. In spite of the best efforts that spanned several decades by the mathematicians of that time, the highest possible accuracy achieved was up to 38 decimal places, and things just got stuck on there. Sir Isaac Newton arrives on the scene not long after that. No one will ever again bisect a polygon after Newton offers his approach. He came up with a formula to calculate the accurate value of pi up to any number of decimal digits we like, that too in an effortlessly easy and time-efficient way. Pi by 4 equals 1 minus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 5 minus 1 by 7 plus 1 by 9 minus 1 by 11 and so on. This is the beautiful formula that Newton developed by applying the concepts of infinity and calculus. Pi is surely a concept of pre-calculus era, but its accurate value to a higher degree of precision is found in the calculus era, the era of great Newton. Pi is such a simple ratio of the circumference to the diameter of a circle, yet it opens the door to all the complication and craziness of calculus. Thanks, and have a nice day.